My name is Samir Gabriel. I'm with Intel Labs, and today we'll be talking about some of the technologies for flow classification, some of which have been pushed already to DPDK version 16.04, and some are coming in the next versions. The outline of my talk, I will start with talk about flow classification in general in DPDK. Then we'll summarize a hashing algorithm that we already pushed in version 2.1, which is cuckoo hashing, and how this optimizes the flow table design. Then we'll introduce our optimizations, which includes two optimizations. One of them is using TSX, the transactional synchronization extensions for Intel, and how this helps in scaling the insert rate for the flow table. Towards the end, I will talk about AVX, the advanced vector instructions, and how we're using that to improve the lookup performance. And this, as Tim was saying, this will be part of 16.11. Then, at the end of my talk, I will talk about a proof of concept, something that we are working on in Intel Labs, and how to support wildcard and variable key size. So I think this picture, I mean, is a well-known network virtualization picture that in the past, everything was running on ASICs and purpose-built hardware. Flow classification has been done in these purpose-built hardware using TCAMs. Flow classification is a very common stage for any network function. For example, if you have a load balancer, you need to know where the target for to load balance to. If you have an IDS or network security device, you need to classify the flow to know whether to accept or reject or do an action on this flow. If you have a router or a switch, you need to classify this flow to see what is the input port and what's the output port. So flow classification is like the first stage or a very common stage for many of the network functions. And usually this has been done on TCAMs for the purpose of having a higher throughput. The TCAMs are great, but they are costly and they are power hungry. So with NFV, what if we are pushing this flow classification on top of general purpose hardware? Can we use the cache hierarchy to have many flows and more flows to do the classification? Can we use the multi-core architecture to scale the lookup performance so multiple cores can work on the classification and have a linear scalability of the classification? So the picture that you see in the slide, this is the general way of doing a flow table. So usually a flow table will consist of a bunch of flow keys and an action when you match on the flow keys. So a packet is coming in, you form your flow key by getting some information from the header and maybe some other information from the payload. You do a hashing on this flow key, and this hash will give you an index in a table. You go into the table, you do a lookup indexing this flow table, and you retrieve one or more keys, because hashing is not perfect and there is always collisions. So you retrieve one or more keys, and at the end you have to match the keys that you retrieved with the input key. If there is a match, you do the action. This is the general flow table for any classification, right? The metrics for a good flow table design is how to design this flow table to achieve three metrics. One of them is, and the most important one is a higher lookup rate. You want to do the lookup very fast, so because this translates into better throughput. This is the first class citizen. Also, you need to have a higher insert rate. You need to be able to update the flows in the table efficiently, especially during initialization time. You need to update that very efficiently. And the third metric is you want an efficient table utilization, which translates into more flows being in the flow table. So you need to support millions of flows to be inserted in the flow table. So these are like the three metrics to design a good flow table. With DPDK, there are multiple libraries doing the classification or the flow classification. The first part of my talk will talk about the exact match library, which is the RTE hash library. We have the ACL and the LPM library also to support variable key size. And towards the end of my presentation, I will talk about some ideas on improving the performance there. So originally, with the original introduction of DPDK, the way of to implement a flow table was the picture that you see on the left-hand side. So you hash your keys, and you insert the keys that hash to this index in a kind of a list. And whenever you are doing a match, you go and you retrieve these keys and match on them. So that's what we call open addressing hashing. And if you are very familiar with the implementation or the previous implementation, the DPDK library was having five packets where you can have five keys matches into this index. With version 2.2, DPDK version 2.2 that was introduced last year, we worked on something called cuckoo hashing. And this was pushed to, it might be 2.1 or 2.2, I'm not sure, but it was pushed to DPDK as of last year. The idea of cuckoo hashing, I will have a slide talking about the details about it, but instead of using a single hash function, it uses two hash functions. And the main target for cuckoo hashing is to have more flows inserted in the table. So having a denser table that fits in the cache. So that's the high-level idea about cuckoo hashing, and it gets its name from the cuckoo bird, the cute little bird on the left-hand side of the slide. The idea of the cuckoo, I mean, why it gets its name from the cuckoo bird is that the cuckoo bird does not build its own nest. So it kind of hacks on the other bird's nest, so it goes and pushes other birds out of its nest. And that's what the cuckoo hashing is doing. So it uses two hash functions, and this six steps listed on the slides is showing you the insert of three keys. So we start with an empty table. With step one, we are trying to insert key number X. We have two hash functions to use, H1 and H2. And each one points to a different index. Both of them are empty, so X will go to its primary location pointed by H1. And the secondary location for X, which is the dotted arrow in picture two, is empty. In step number three, another key is coming in, which is Y. Again, the two locations for Y is empty, so Y goes to its primary location in step number four and points to the secondary location that it can go to. The pushing part or the cuckoo part is coming on picture number five. So now we have a key to be inserted, which is Z. In that case, we have two hash functions. H1 is pointing to the same location as X. So Z will push X out of its location, and X will go to its secondary location. So you can imagine that keys are pushing other keys around to have room to insert more and more keys. And that's the point of cuckoo hashing, is that it allows for more keys to be inserted in the flow table. The kind of results that we get running cuckoo hashing is shown in this figure, which The y-axis is the table load or the table occupancy at which the first insertion failure happens, which means you are trying to insert a key and it comes out and saying, I cannot insert it. With the traditional open addressing scheme, you can see this happening at around 8%. So only 8% of the table is loaded, but you are getting rejections because I cannot insert this table or this key. With cuckoo hashing, this can go up to 95%. So you can have more and more keys in the flow table. And we have tested with the RTE hash library that is in DPDK today, and we can support 64 million keys, five tuple, is easily supported with the cuckoo hashing library in DPDK today. It's just a snippet on how to use the RTE hash API. You just, if you want to create a flow table, you call RTE hash create. Adding a key is simply by calling the function called add key. There are two lookup functions. One is called lookup data, which is only looking up one key. But the more efficient one is lookup bulk, which you get a pointer for the key array, and it looks up multiple keys at the same time. So let me stop here and for any questions.
Can you go back to the previous slide?
Yeah, this one?
No, the previous one. The previous one.
The previous one?
Yeah. Why not insert Z into hash number 2 instead of pushing X out?
That's how cuckoo hashing works, is that by pushing, so you first try the primary location. If there's somebody there, you push the what is there into its secondary location. So it you can always put in the secondary and point to the primary, but that's how cuckoo hashing works. I mean, it has to be, you have to pick one of them, either a primary or the secondary. So that's how it works.
No, you're pushing it out, right?
You are pushing it out, so the X moves to the secondary location.
That's an expensive operation. You're doing twice, right? Like maybe the other one, maybe.
You are adding the price of writing a key that has been already inserted with the gain of inserting more keys. So the insert operation is slower than the original open hashing, open addressing scheme. But the lookup operation is easy. You have only to look up on two locations, the primary and the secondary. If it is not there, then it is not there. So you are paying the price on the insert with a lookup that is not very expensive compared to the open addressing scheme. Any more questions? Yeah.
Hi.
Hello.
How is this different from the duo table hashing? Basically, you have essentially it's like you have a same duo hashing table, and each one have a different hashing function and try to apply
that. The family of multiple. I mean, it is a family of using multiple hashes to design a flow table. It is within the same family, but the cuckoo hashing, the only thing extra is that it pushes things around.
Okay.
So that's the only difference between using. There are multiple hashing schemes that you are using two hash functions.
So the hashing function essentially is kind of similar, like using CCITT.
So the hashing function here can be any hashing function. We are using CRC,
okay.
Or the library is using CRC, but you can use whatever hash function you want.
Got it.
The principle is the same for any hash function.
Thanks.
Any more questions?
I have a question here. Hello. Yeah. And. Example number 5.
Yes.
If W came in, the key W, which yes. Hashes to the same location like X.
Yes.
Now X is replaced by Z. So it will push Z out, and you put W in, and then what if W second, where will be W second location? One of the four locations in.
If a new key W is coming in, it will have two locations, each one of W that is pointing to X and H2 that is pointing somewhere that can be free or empty, right?
Yeah.
So W will push X around, X will go to will push Z. Will push Z around. Z will push X. X will push somebody else, and you go into a linear search of paths until you find an empty slot. And that's actually my next slide. Is that you will have these cuckoo passes of long displacement that we want to solve.
If more than in this example, where we have two tables. And each one has four entries.
By the way, it is not two tables. It is just locations. It is one single table, but just pointers, right?
OK, thank you.
Sure. There's a question.
So my question is, I understand the point that it always look for the primary. If the secondary is empty, then it's OK to push whatever the key you already have. So for example, figure number 5, Z is try to get into X, but X has a secondary location which is empty. That is the reason you kick out X. What happens if Z is pointing, primary and secondary both pointing to the same location as of X?
Yeah, can you hold just this thought? I mean, because this will be my next slide. Okay.
So how many levels do you go there for collisions? Suppose when you're looking up a new key, right? So you try, a third key comes, for example, and it has to go to Z, right? And then the second level is X, right? And there are things, I mean, there is already something in both the locations. So then you have to find a third location.
You keep pushing, you keep pushing. So let's go into this example then. So that's a very good question, which is the same question here is when you are trying, I mean, when you are inserting, you kind of, with the cuckoo hashing, you kind of having a long cuckoo pass to insert. So in that case, we have, we are inserting Y, and Y is pointing to A. A is, I mean, to primary location. A is, its primary location is occupied by E and so on. So you keep going through this tree until every key is pushing to the next one from its primary location until you find an empty slot, which happens to be T has an empty secondary slot. Okay?
So then when you don't find a key, then you have to do 9 lookups, right?
No. So that's the insert. Your lookups are always, you are always two hash functions, the primary and the secondary.
Oh.
The lookups is always, the lookup is only is always fast. You have two locations, primary and secondary, you look them up. If they are there, okay, if not, then there is no match. But the insert is what takes longer and has long passes.
But why only primary and secondary? Because it can be up to 9 locations, right?
So each one has only 2 locations. So this is the insert, right? So A is pointing, the primary is pointing to E. The primary is pointing to, E is already in its secondary location, it's pointing to S and so on. This is only during the insert.
Okay.
Make sense?
Yeah, I don't know.
Maybe you can talk offline about that, but the only the insert is where you are pushing keys around. And the problem, and here is the problem is that this, as all you have noticed, the problem with this is that the cuckoo pass can tend to be long. And in this example, you have 9 writes for 1 insert. So that's OK. But the issue is, what if you have multiple cores trying to, you want to scale the performance of the inserts. So you want to have multiple cores trying to do the insertion at the same time. Then your critical pass will be the time it takes to do the 9 writes. And if you if any of the passes is intersecting, that's a collision, and you cannot allow for multiple writers to go and insert at the same time. And this slows down the insert. So with 16.04, we introduced an insert optimization for the RTE hash library or the cuckoo hash library. And this insert optimization is based on 2 things. The first one is making use of Intel hardware feature called transactional synchronization extension. And another optimization, which is trying to change the code to minimize the size of the critical section itself. So with TSX, the way TSX works is simple. The hardware itself takes care about concurrency. So instead of the figure, instead of this picture that you see here, I mean, assume that this is a critical section. Today, if you are going into critical section, you will have a lock before entering and unlock after exiting the critical section. And only one thread is able to go through, and any other thread will not be able to go through. With TSX, the hardware itself is monitoring the cache lines. So instead of these big software locks that you are using in your critical section, the hardware or the CPU is monitoring each cache line with, you can call it, I mean, a virtual lock. And the CPU is looking who is accessing this cache line. And if two threads are writing to the same cache line, it roll back the execution to guarantee correctness. So with TSX, if these threads are not touching the same cache line, they can go concurrently and write to the values. And you can imagine that with a huge flow table, there is a very big probability that the keys that you are writing are not all residing on the cache line. So the TSX can, I mean, with TSX, these threads can go ahead and write the new key value. So that's the first optimization that we used, which is using TSX. The second optimization is simple. And instead of, which is changing the code path itself to do the insert, and instead of doing the depth first search to find the location of the empty slot, we changed that to a breadth first search. So instead of, in the same example that I gave in the last slide, instead of the 9 writes to find the empty slot with breadth first, you are only finding it after 3, actually 4 writes in that case. Also, we in the code itself, we split the code into two pieces. One that is multi-thread safe, which is searching for the path, because searching the path itself is not unsafe, so you can have multiple threads searching at the same time with no problem. And the multi-thread unsafe part, which is you are writing the actual key, is the one that you want to protect with TSX. So you will see that the code is split first doing the search, and after doing the search, you unlock, you lock using TSX, you do the writes, and then you unlock using TSX. So that's the changes that we pushed to the RTE hash library. And with this kind of changes, this is the result that we get with our Broadwell server. So you will see there is the color here are not correct. The optimized is not red, in that case it is blue. But you will see that the blue line is the insert rate in millions insertion per second compared to the original case of not using TSX and not optimizing the code. So you'll see with TSX we can improve the performance of the insert rate almost linearly with the number of cores. And you can imagine that all this shaded area is the gain that we gain on top of using the regular locks in software. So that's what the library that is already in 16.04 is doing. The way of using this, 1607. The way of using this library is quite easy. In the RTE hash.h, you will see a flag called multi-writer. And this flag is, if this flag is set, then you are enabling multi-writers. And you are just checking on the flags in the library. If this flag is set, you go and you work with TSX. So I'm just encouraging all of you to go and play with this library, make sure that just see the performance of using this library in your platform. So this is the optimizations for insertion. I can stop here and if there are any questions on TSX.
Can you explain how breadth first search was applied in this case? Because the way you explained about cuckoo search, right, it naturally lends to depth first search.
Yes.
So how would you maintain consistency with the algorithm if you did BFS?
Okay. So with the RT hash library, you can insert the key in multiple buckets, right? So. The original picture was only giving you two buckets, right? With the current RT hash library, you can have four buckets. So instead of going into depth first for the first bucket, you are going first bucket, second bucket, till the fourth bucket, and do a breadth first search on all of them first before consuming and going into the second level. So it's just moving in breadths of the over the packets instead of going onto one packet depths first.
Okay. And one more observation: when you mentioned about TSX, I'm not familiar with it, but it sounds very much like what used to exist on the MIPS platforms with the load, link, store, conditional pair of operations. Is that what it is?
Sorry, I'm not familiar about.
Okay, the MIPS. It basically monitors the cache line and checks if anybody else has written.
My information about TSX, yes, it is doing that, but I'm not very fully aware about MIPS and what it is doing. But with TSX, you are monitoring cache lines and seeing who is accessing it, and if there is a conflict, the hardware rolls back the execution.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. There is another question. Sorry, go ahead.
Hello. So about the TSX, I see that how the TSX is preventing, you know, multi-writers, you know, when two cores are writing into the same location, which says that what happened is if it caught that two writes are happening, it will roll back. But then how the execution proceed then?
So it rolls back and wait, the hardware itself is doing it. So the hardware is rolling back and waiting and to see whether
the hardware basically take care of it.
But if there is no progress, the writes will be serialized.
I see
what will happen if there was already software locks, big locks, to you are serializing the writes.
Okay. Thank you.
DPDK version 16.11, we are also pushing another optimization for the RT hash library, which is the exact match hash library in DPDK. For that, we are looking into how to optimize the lookup rate itself. So we used the patch that will push will use the AVX.
Hi, I had a question about the TSX that you explained before. Not
yes.
Very familiar with it, but how does it work when you have cores on different sockets? Or is it L1 cache, L2 cache?
So the results that you have seen on this result is based on Broadwell, which has 22 cores per socket. So we have tested on a single socket so far. I don't have results on a multi-socket platform.
Even on a single socket, would it work at, say, the L2 cache or lower level cache? What I'm asking is, do all the 22 cores that you said, they all can potentially be writers and it'll serialize all of them?
sorry, can you repeat the question?
Oh, sorry. So you said that you tested on a 22-core system, right? So can all the 22
but,
cores...
But these 22 cores are on a single socket.
Right. So yeah. They can all potentially be writers, and TSX will serialize all
TSX the TSX will not serialize unless there is a conflict.
Okay.
So if they are writing on different location in the flow table, you don't need to serialize them. So the TSX will detect that there is no conflict and they will go concurrently. Only if there is a conflict, the TSX will detect that in hardware and will serialize that. But this is will rarely happen in a flow table that's 64 million keys.
Okay.
You are doing nine writes or whatever number of writes. It's very the probability that you are really writing on each other feet is really small. So you don't really need to serialize everything. You just leave it to the hardware to detect it, and if there is a problem, it will roll back or serialize in that case.
Thanks.
I had a question regarding the TSX slide that you explained. So in that in the diagram that you said about this one.
Yes.
So in this, from my understanding, if there are different buckets in this scenario, like nine buckets, as I can see with the DFS approach, do you imply that there are nine hash functions? Or with each bucket, do you mean that there are going to be four hash functions, so like what you were saying previously?
With each bucket, there are two hash functions. So
okay.
There are always two hash functions with cuckoo hashing. But for each bucket, there are two locations for the key in this bucket. So
okay.
So the keys in this bucket this might be the primary location for this key, or can be the second location. There are only two hash functions.
All right, so that means in this diagram, you would say that there would be four hash functions, one
no,
bucket having two.
Still two hash functions, but four buckets, which means four keys can go into this location.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so for the lookup optimization, we again are making use of hardware optimizations and features. So we are using the advanced vector instructions, the AVX, Intel AVX instructions. So instead of, you can think about when you're doing a lookup on a packet, you are repeating a lot of operations. You are doing the hashing, and then with the hashing, you are going and fetching keys and fetching values and doing the compare and all of this. So it is a lot of repeated operations that are happening on the same bucket or the same key. So this is a very good candidate to use vector instruction, where vector instruction is that you are doing the same operation you are doing it on different data. So that's why we introduced the AVX. So with the AVX, instead of doing it one by one or packet by packet or a key by key, we are doing it on a vector. And also we are optimizing the code of the lookup a little bit more by making use of prefetching and making sure that all the functions that we're calling are inline functions, and changing the pipeline model a little bit for the RT hash. I don't have the exact code because this has not pushed out yet, but the kind of improvement that we see with these optimizations is around 35% across multiple flow table size. So the x-axis will be the number of keys in the flow table, and the y-axis will be the throughput in cores or in lookups per core per second. And we see consistently around 30 to 35% improvement with this kind of optimizations that is already in the roadmap for the 16.11. So I'm just giving you a heads up that wait for this optimization to come up in 16.11 and use it, and you should see better performance on the exact match library. Yes.
So why use cuckoo hashing instead of something like stratified trees, which can give you order of log n for searching?
So the cuckoo hashing is a library for exact match. Trees are more...
Oh, stratified trees also exact match.
Yes, but are more suited, I mean, at least in my mind, it's more suited for wildcard matching and so on. But, I mean, you can use we have the ACL library. We have the LBM library in DPDK. You can use it for matching and compare the performance. But at least in my experience, with exact match, the RT hash library is quite performant.
Thank you.
And having said that, we in the labs, we are also, I mean, this is has nothing to do with the DPDK itself, but we are also trying to see how we can optimize the wildcard matching or the ACL library. So one way of optimizing the ACL library is to have a multiple table or instead of using a tree, we search across many subtables. And this is a technique that is being used in OVS today. So in OVS today, what they do is that they have the exact match cache at the bottom, but in the MegaFlow cache, the one in the middle, they have, to support wildcard, they have a subtable search, which means that they have multiple subtables, and each subtable is for a given key size or a given mask. And whenever you have a flow to match on this flow table, you go and sequentially search this subtable. So in the MegaFlow cache, you will see that you get a bucket header, you go and search one by one until you find a match. And with the OVS guys have done a great job on making sure that a key is only inserted into one table. So as soon as you find your first match, you terminate. So this is a way of doing wildcard support or variable key size matching with subtable search. And kind of orthogonal to the ACL or the tree base, but that's one way of doing variable key size. In Intel Labs, we are thinking of ways to improve this kind of flow lookup. So instead of searching sequentially the different subtables, what if we have something that will tell us which subtable to go and search first? And that's in abstraction, that's what we are trying to do, the two-layer lookup approach that we are thinking of. So we're thinking of, instead of doing sequential search on the subtables, having this first level of indirection, getting the packet key or the packet header, we go through this level of indirection, and then this will point us to which subtable to look into. One technology that we are thinking of using as this first level of indirection is the plume filter. So we have a series of plume filters for each subtable. We get the key. We go and instead of checking each subtable, are just checking the plume filter whether this key is inserted in this subtable or not. And only for the plume filters that says the key might have been inserted, we go and search the subtable. Again, this is just a proof of concept, very preliminary results. And this is the kind of gain that we see using the plume filter. So the gain increases with the number of subtables. And the x-axis here is cycles, which are cycles to do the lookup. So the lower, the better. And you can see that two cases when you are hitting on a flow, the OVS hit, the OVS miss. And when you are doing the hit and miss with the plume filter, we kind of see 2 to 4x improvement with this plume filter approach, which is skipping many of the local or the subtable sequential search. So I think that's what I have. Any questions? I'll be happy to answer them.
When the hash algorithm and the table size needs to change when the insertion fails, what happens then? Do you see a spike in packet drops? Or because the graph doesn't represent that, right?
Yes, so as any hash table, whenever you have failure, whenever you cannot insert the key, you have to rehash the whole table. But you don't, I mean, a good approach to that is that you don't need to really wait until you have failures to start doing the rehashing. So you can start doing the rehashing earlier. Like if you have like table load about 90%, you know that the failure will happen. And you can start building this table offline while you are meanwhile you are doing lookup at the same time. So the offline building, and then you can switch whenever the table is ready. But yes, for sure, any hash table will, whenever you are doing the rehashing, you have to drop packets.
No, or but this is only the case for open addressing schemes, right? When if we have chaining, then the
if you have chaining, then you I mean, if with the original chaining, you are limiting that to 5. But if it is like unlimited buckets, you will go and do a linear search on all of them. But most of the permutations that I have seen are not making it open addressing really open. There is still a limit on how many packets that you will go through.
So what is an indicator that I need to rehash again? In chaining, I have the length of the chain.
Table load. I mean, how many flows that you are, I mean, at least that's the first thing that comes to my mind. How many flows that is already in the table versus the table size that you have created at the beginning. So I guess with the graph that I shown that you are getting a failure at 90-something%, so you can have the threshold set at like 80-something. Whenever you have this table load crossing this 80-something mark, you can start rehashing.
No,
any more questions?
Different hashing algorithms, or even different data structures like sketches. So my question is, what's the major momentum that behind to drive you to choose cuckoo hashing? Is that something after?
So the main motivation for cuckoo hashing, I mean, when we originally pushed that to DPDK, was to have more flows inserted in the table. So with cuckoo hashing, we were starting to see a table of size like 32 million flows, 64 million flows. This is something that we really wanted to, a very big table size for some of the applications that we are working on. So this was the why we went to cuckoo hashing, because it can fit more and more flows in the flow table. And then the work that we are trying to work on now is, given this is our table design, how we optimize that. So we optimize the insert using TSX, and now we are pushing another optimization using, we're optimizing the lookup using AVX.
Is using other algorithms on your roadmaps?
You are free to implement your own flow table design, but I'm saying that the motivation behind cuckoo hashing was to have more and more flows inserted in the flow table.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay. I think we're probably out of time, Sammy. Thank you very
Thank you.
Much. Great session.